So Lūʻau is a Hawaiian feast, and I think that word has been coined for probably the tourist industry, because we would call it an ʻahaʻaina. We would call it a gathering where food is shared, friendship, aloha with each other, and families and friends gather to celebrate something. Traditionally, ʻahaʻaina was used for ceremonial purposes. So we talk about, for in my tradition, for the uniki or the graduation rituals, for moving from a dancer to a chanter and drummer, or to a kumu hula, a master teacher of Hawaiian dance. It's also used for celebration of family things, right?
And it could be everything from, you know, the first year of a child's life, to, you know, a graduation, to a wedding, to a, you know, a landmark occasion like
a 50th birthday party. Yeah.
You know, reflecting on what Auntie Vicky said about the ʻahaʻaina and the luau, you know, there is some kind of connection, you know, that is recognizable in the word luau, because it is, you know, one of the dishes that's served at ʻahaʻaina, and you know, that's derived from the taro plant. And of course, for us as Hawaiians, it's one of the most significant, you know, if not the most significant thing related to our existence. Definitely one of the staple foods, definitely present at just about every you know, Hawaiian celebration and every meal, as a matter of fact, you know.
So we look at the kalo as being our ancestor. Right. Papa and Wakea, Sky Father and Earth Mother, gave birth to the you know, the islands.
Right.
Gave birth to all of the islands, Kapai, Aina, O Hawaii. And then Hoku Kalani and Wakea gave birth to an unborn fetus that was planted, and that was the first taro plant. Mm-hmm. So the Lau Kapalili, you see, when you look across the taro field, you see all the leaves that are fluttering in the breeze in a
Kaloa Nakalau Kapalili, the taro plant with the long stem and the leaves that tremble in the wind. And you know, that's such a beautiful sight to see. You know, standing across the taro patch or the mala, and the you know, the taro are just shimmering in the wind, and they're talking to us like our ancestors are calling us back to our roots and our you know, our very existence.
And that gives us our relationship for, and then we were the next ones to be born. So in our Hawaiian creation stories, there was the birth of the islands, there was the birth of the kalo plant, and then the kanaka or the man. And so that sets up our relationship to the land, and that the taro is our older sibling. And the idea of malama aina, to take care of the land, because if you take care of the land will then feed you. And that's the reciprocal relationship that we have with the aina and with the taro plant before us, and with our gods that gave birth to all of us. The idea of sharing luau with visitors, you know, came in with the tourist industry, because really it's to celebrate that is really a celebration for our family, where our family gathers and they all come bring food, and we all share camaraderie, and we help to prepare, we help to set up, we help to cook, and then we help to clean up, and in the meantime we kanikapila. And in every family there's people that will do the cooking, that will do the cleaning, that will do the singing, that will do the dancing. So every family has those aunties and the uncles and the keiki and the nephews. This is a place where we can share the water flows and feeds the lo'i, the taro patches, mm-hmm. and where we can continue to practice our cultural practices with our families mm-hmm. and those visitors that want to learn more about that.
Right.
So yeah, you can come, but you have to work. You have to be a part of the community that works into it, gets your feet and toes into the mud.
It's not just something where we sit down and have fun, although, you know, we're gonna have fun.
Yeah.
But you walk away enlightened, and you walk away with new mana and energy and essence, so.
And I think in doing all of this, it's a lot of hard work.
Yeah.
So we hope that what you learn from this is how much work it takes to do this.
Yeah.
How much work is involved in making food, Hawaiian food, in doing an imu, in making a luau. How much work is involved in the training of dancers and musicians and singers to learn the songs and the stories.
Yeah, there's a old Hawaiian saying called, "A'ohe hana nui ke alo ia." And basically what that means is there's no task too large if you do it in numbers, you know. We all, that's the Hawaiian way. We help each other out. We have a job, you know. We know what the task is. We do it, we get it done. No one complains, and then we move on. Yeah. You know, that's the beauty of traditional culture. Everyone had a place, and we just awamo or carry that responsibility, and you know.
And that's how we build community, how we build relationships. So the person that's next to me, I may not have met them before, but we're working together. And so now I know who they are and we can help.
It's really the journey that is the thing that's the most valuable. You know, all the lessons you learn and all the relationships you build and finding out your weaknesses, strengths, what you need to learn better.
The entertainment and the music are those that I will gonna celebrate after when we're eating the food. But the idea for holding a luau is the preparation of it and the sharing of the knowledge of how to prepare food with the next generation. So in order to perpetuate that tradition, you gotta teach the next generation how to make the food, how to prepare the food from beginning. So it means from the digging of the hole for the imu to the setting of the, to you know, chopping the wood. What kind of wood? You cannot use just any kind of wood, right? To laying the stones, you cannot use any kind of stones. They have to be specially selected stones. And even when you make you prepare the pig, you have to select the stones that are right for the cavity of the pig. Mm-hmm. They don't all fit in the same place. You know, you have a skinny one that goes in the neck and a nice round one for the opu and the kind of flat ones for the groin. So those are all the eyeball, the person, the master, kind of see that in the hot oven, in the heat, and just say, that one, you know, give me that one, or they'll point, or they'll be able to communicate. So that's the part, you're passing that knowledge, that ike, down from one generation to the next, is the skill in preparing the food. In the preparation of all of that, there's a whole bunch of other people that are gonna like, Kani Kapila, the aunties that are going to come and play ukulele while that's going on, or singing songs because, you know, the men are doing the work, the men are doing the cooking. And so, and a lot of times the women are also in the kitchen preparing their special items. And then or the aunties will come along with their ukulele and just sing along as all that's going that's happening. But when it's time to sit down and eat, then you really want some hula and some Hawaiian music to go on.
I really feel like the other end, the hula and the mele, the music, you know, it all kind of culminates. It's like a combination, because we have, you know, our people, we're from a society that passed things down through oral knowledge. And, you know, without the music, without the mele, the chant, the hula, you know, that it's basically what it is. It's an aha, it's a meeting, and they're explaining, they're telling stories of our very being, of this beautiful place, of haiku, of, you know, it's really a combination. And I think that the two together, it, you know, combined with that community aspect, it's, you know,
yeah,
it's,
so maybe the luau, you know, the aha aina, yeah, is just the feast, the right meal, right? And the luau is the feast and the entertainment and the music and the dance all together. So it's really a good luau, yeah, when you have all of those components, yeah. It's an okay if you just have a good food. Yeah. But it ain't, you still, there's no luau without music and dance. There's none. It's been a great experience, yeah, for the two of
fun.
Us. Yeah, it's been fun.
It's been, and it's been an honor for me. And, you know, I'm so grateful to Auntie Vicky and Pa'i Foundation. And you know, there's so many contributors to all of the efforts, you know, to this just great production.
Yeah.
You know, it's been a joy. It's, you know, it's grueling work. It's hard work. You know,
yeah,
my body aches and I need some sleep. We,
yeah,
both do. But, you know, at the end of it, you know, this is a memorable occasion, and it's really what a luau is all about. It's,
yeah,
it's commemorating something unique, and you know.
And we want to thank the Smithsonian for inviting us to
absolutely
share the story.
Absolutely,
because,
yeah,
you know, the story,
yeah,
that's really important that we're able to share this story. So I want to thank the Smithsonian, Kealoha,
yeah,
and I want to extend our appreciation,
yeah,
for this opportunity to,
yeah,
share a little bit about what Hawaii means to us, about what our islands mean to us, and what about, and the story about the luau. So mahalo nui loa.
Mahalo.
to fall. How I wonder who's keeping us apart. Don't blunder and give away your heart. You really